Are leaders made or born? Though the question begs that both might be important, I wondered how leaders were made, and why certain aspects shape leaders to become who they are. For instance, what actually helps shape a leader to be a good leader? Why do some moments help shape a leader to be braver, while to another, it becomes the Achilles heel? If leaders are indeed made, what should more companies be doing to tap into their next generation of leaders as the world continues to get more complex and nuanced? I got curious and talked to a few leaders to learn about what's going on in the workplace as of late. This is what I learned. Hi, this is Monica King, and you're listening to Dear Workplace, where we study trends, changes, and challenges about people at work.
I mean, I worked for somebody growing up. I think I was there 19 years. Never once got a thank you. And so every time, I don't care what it is, even if someone just hands me a paper, I say, thank you. You know, it's just a little thing, but you know, people pick up on that.
What's been very evident and clear, especially now, is how much power leaders have in how to influence the masses or just, you know, the community. And you know, seeing the importance of how values are absolutely important within a leader. And you may have someone who's very talented, very charismatic, very articulate in being able to tell stories, project a vision of the future. But if those leaders are rooted in wrong kinds of values, you can really lead a large people astray in terms of going in the wrong direction.
Yeah, I think planning, leadership, and public speaking are industry agnostic. They're also role agnostic. So no matter what you choose to pursue in your career, no matter what you choose to do, the reality is that you're always going to need to be effective at those skills. You're either consuming something or you're selling something. And so in both opportunities and in both avenues, we always will need those skills. And so I think being able to advocate for yourself, being able again to make your perspective known, and then also being able to communicate effectively and sometimes even persuasively is always to our benefit.
Yeah, we can expect pretty strong mental health impact from being constantly in fight, flight, or freeze mode because we just don't know what's going on. But, you know, the thing that you're saying, like these companies who do, I think that they're rare. I feel like a lot of leaders are, yeah, carrying on. And there was a recent case in the UK. I don't know if you heard. I think it was he the chairman of one of the big four consulting, or somebody on the board of big four consulting company, who's no longer on the board of a big four consulting company after this comment, and just said, like, people should stop using the pandemic as an excuse and stop whining about it or something like that.
Students' willingness to be okay to look silly and being okay with taking a risk and maybe getting a question wrong, like being okay with maybe this isn't right, but I'm gonna try. Like just being willing to try and not be perfect at it, and being okay to kind of put yourself out there and, like, you know, maybe I'll be wrong, maybe I'll look foolish, and that's okay. Like, I really wish that they understood that more, because I'm observing that for fear of even being looked at a certain way.
So one, you know, one thing is just sort of being intentional. Two is creating the time, which I'm also, you know, trying to do in different ways, at least an hour a day, you know, setting aside time to learn a new skill or, you know, read something new that might be nothing to do with our day-to-day work. But, you know, in some ways it is, because it allows me to think in a slightly different way, to connect dots perhaps to other issues that I might not have thought of. And, you know, all of that is useful.
Welcome to Dear Workplace by Innovators Box. I'm your host, Monica King, and today I'm eager to dive into the topic of leadership. If who we surround ourselves with matters, what can we do more or less of in the workplace to become a better leader? What skills will become more important? What training should we be providing or taking? Has COVID changed what we appreciate in leadership? These questions come at a timely moment as we reach the end of June 2021. The U.S. Labor Department has said that we are going through a huge workforce migration. Millions changing jobs, leaving jobs, starting companies, and even switching industries. What kind of leader would lead thoughtfully and gracefully during these changing times? My gut instinct turned out to be right. COVID has shifted some of our attention to appreciate certain aspects of leadership even more. If your boss is being difficult, people are speaking up, which means as a leader, it's time you triple upgrade your communication and people skills. Yes, as some of you have heard, people don't leave jobs. They leave managers. It's true. This statement reflects how poor management and leadership makes many people's lives miserable at work. That's because a leader has a lot of influence over its people and what they do, how they work, and how they are appreciated. And while before COVID, such an attitude and behavior was always frowned upon, the pandemic pushed people to finally say, we are no longer putting up with this BS.
Yeah, we can expect pretty strong mental health impact from being constantly in fight, flight, or freeze mode, because we just don't know what's going on. But, you know, the thing that you're saying, like these companies who do, I think that they're rare. I feel like a lot of leaders are, yeah, carrying on. And there was a recent case in the UK. I don't know if you heard. I think it was he the chairman of one of the big four consulting, or somebody on the board of big four consulting company, who's no longer on the board of a big four consulting company after this comment, and just said, like, people should stop using the pandemic as an excuse and stop whining about it or something like that.
Meet Jennifer Shinkai, a coach and facilitator who helps leaders tap into their potential. As a coach in Tokyo, she has served a global audience. She sees how this time has been so key for us to deepen our empathy and active listening skills as leaders who want to truly serve their people and not treat them as folks just doing a task. I asked her if she could give another example of how leaders could take different actions to relate to others.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's having huge impact. And we were talking before about, like, coming on camera. So many people are not putting in that water cooler chat, not having those moments that you would have when you just went out for a casual lunch. So just doing those basics of asking, how are you? And then saying, no, how are you really? What do you need from me? What's your family situation? And opening that up so that you can support your team and you understand what their bandwidth capabilities are and what's going on. And just having that, I think really this is the time to, like, be more human, not to to ignore those things.
Be more human, leaders. You are a person beyond your title. I've also shared in a recent interview with The Economist about how this time has pushed us to remember that we are never a human doing, but a human being. Jennifer reminds me that as leaders, it's key we take the time to practice that concept even more as we lead. But to do that well, you have to start with another area: knowing your core values and who you are.
You know, seeing the importance of how values are absolutely important within a leader. And you may have someone who's very talented, very charismatic, very, you know, very articulate in being able to tell stories, project a vision of the future. But if those leaders are rooted in wrong kinds of values, you can really lead a large people astray in terms of going in the wrong direction. And so I think from someone who works with a lot of leaders, you see the importance of not only ensuring that leaders have kind of they're the capabilities and the practical aspects of being a leader, but there is a more fundamental, really, about values, about beliefs and philosophy, and also just the heart for what's motivating you to become that leader, right? And so as someone who works in leadership education, I think that's really oftentimes we gloss over this whole question of values and stuff like that and say, oh, it's kind of personal. But really, that's really a fundamental part of leadership development and really exploring those areas and making sure people do understand and really understand why they're doing what they're doing and seeing if they are doing it for the right reasons.
Meet my friend, Abraham Kim, known as Abe. While he currently serves the Korean American community as the executive director of the Council of Korean Americans, he has played a crucial role in helping MIDI leaders in the military, nonprofits, and corporations find their voice and hone their leadership skills by fostering safe rooms and building bridges for them. And the values Abe shares here is really powerful. One thing we're certainly seeing more of its leaders who not only know how to lead tactically, but also lead with their hearts. Leaders who know what their people feel and who are in touch with their humanity. This is why Abe shares how another area more leaders will have to do better is taking care of one's mental health.
I think mental health of leaders has become an important part of the conversation of what we do. Again, you know, there's oftentimes we can learn a lot of practical skills and, you know, how to do public speaking better or, you know, doing spreadsheets better, whatever the case may be. But there's also an important kind of mental resiliency aspect of this that we as educators and mentors and other people working in these communities need to also focus on. We tend to forget that as well. And it really comes out during these times where there is a lot of volatility in our environment, a lot of uncertainty in our communities, and leaders are put under a lot of stress and a lot of pressure are put on them to find solutions of problems that all our communities are facing. And oftentimes, you know, we look to leaders, but forget the fact that they're humans too, with all kinds of demands on their life.
Remember to be human. It's something we want more, but often forget. And I admit, this is something I share too and want to honor more, but at times forget to fully prioritize when things get busy. I remember reading Elon Musk's tweet of how he had little sleep and Arianna Huffington responding back saying to get more sleep and rest. How will you give yourself more rest and space to be human so that you could lead your team through these ambiguous and complex times better? And, by chance, is there a way we can learn how to do this through training? The leadership trainer part of me couldn't help but wonder. So I talked to someone who has been thinking a lot about this too. A friend who leads a team at DoorDash, builds leadership programs, and is also an executive coach. Brandy Nicole Johnson.
Yeah, I think we're in a very interesting time where I think the pandemic has forced some things on us that I always knew were coming. So for example, I think leadership development traditionally has always been delivered very much in a lecture format where there's someone at the front of the room teaching or delivering content, and you may or may not have an opportunity to put those skills into practice. So I am a strong advocate and a proponent of experiential education and giving people an opportunity to practice in their learning environment what it is that you just shared with them. And so that's something that I would love to continue to see in industry rather than this way of saying that we have to stay with what we've always done. Because as we've learned throughout the last 18 months alone, what we've always done doesn't necessarily serve us or give us an opportunity to continue to grow, especially if we find that it's no longer effective. So I would love to see a continuous transformation of people being willing to make the investment in learning and development and also leadership development. I think one of the other things we don't do well stateside that I would like for us to shift and change is having this notion or this narrative that just because you are an effective individual contributor means that you will be an effective people manager. And I want that narrative destroyed. There are two different skill sets that are needed in order to show up effectively in each of those capacities. And we really need to give other people an opportunity to not only create a vision for their career, but to lead their careers and knowing that we are always at choice and we always have a choice. You don't have to just move up in your career. You can also move in a completely different direction than you ever thought was possible. I never thought I was going to leave the nonprofit sector. And ultimately I did, but I didn't realize that that was even possible for me when I started my career.
Yes, yes, yes. Brandy has been a coach and facilitator and has played a key role in leadership development in organizations like Center for Creative Leadership, WeWork, Red Hat, Harvard Business Review, Starting Block, Estella Elaine, her company, and now at DoorDash. I appreciate it, Brandy's point, that we have to first dismantle seeing being a leader as the only way of growing in your career. People skills and technical skills are two different things. And if leading and managing people is not something you enjoy, you can still be a leader through your technical expertise. I first learned of this nuance while working at the government. Some of the scientists I met shared how conflicted they felt growing their career as they wanted to do more research, but felt that being in management was the only path towards promotion and career growth. That being said, some scientists purposely chose to stay in their roles as experts and advisors instead of chasing management roles, as they did not want to manage people, and instead focus on researching. It always got me curious, realizing that that's right. Why do we see managing people to be the only promotion? It seems backwards, especially if that's not the skill for everyone. And Brandy agreed. She shared a bit on why distinguishing managing skills from leadership skills is a key aspect. They are both important, but two very different skills.
Because I think we make the mistake of making those terms interchangeable, and they are not. I believe that leadership is an equal employment opportunity, if you will. Anybody has the capacity or the opportunity to be a leader. I think it's really about stepping up, about taking ownership of what's happening, and then also being willing to be held accountable for the outcome of whatever results emerge. Management, on the other hand, requires a different skill set. You're usually, as a manager, focusing on the skills and the organization of other people, other goals, of accelerating your team's performance. And it's a very, again, it's a very different focus. I find that most of the time, leaders need to have some kind of vision of success in mind of what does success truly look like. Whereas managers, again, are putting in really thinking about what resources, what tools, what capital do I need to deliver on my leader's vision, if you will. I'm not saying that, and I'm in this place myself, I'm not just a manager, I'm also a leader. So in order to be an effective manager, though, I must lead and have a vision for my team to be able to succeed. And so I think the distinction is critically important.
So what skills are important then to lead?
I think one of the skills that, again, I think both roles need to be able to give and receive feedback well. So not only being able to give people feedback to let them know what it is that they've done well and what it is that they might need to do differently, but also as a leader and a manager to be able to demonstrate that you're open to feedback as well. I think one of the reasons why people remain ineffective is because they are either resistant to feedback or they haven't given enough feedback. And so it's really important to cultivate that gift and to help people understand what you want them to start doing, stop doing, and continue doing in real time. I'd say another thing that I think is really important in terms of skill set, especially in a time like 2021, is to be prepared to be agile. I don't believe that change is optional. I believe change is continuous, that change is unforgiving and never ending. And yet, I do believe growth is optional. I believe growth is a choice. And so because change is unforgiving, I think we need to just go ahead and be prepared for that. We need to be prepared to shift and change as the world and as our company may dictate. And so I think that's important. It's an important skill to cultivate as well.
Yes, Brandy. The arts of feedback and agility are so key. I've also noticed how just because our feedback communication or agility workforce worked for one colleague doesn't mean that it would be the same with another, since the way we speak and engage is different for each person. This is where going back to Abe and Jennifer's advice in really taking the time to know yourself, your values, and why will also help you learn why certain settings make it easier for you to take or share feedback or lead change, and how you could use those insights to lead those changes when the circumstances are different. So if those are things that we should note as leaders in the workplace today, is there anything else we should note as a student or Gen Z who wants to be a leader? Meet Jadea Spencer, the executive director at the International Youth Leadership Institute, where they empowered new generation of visionary leaders from the African diaspora with leadership and accountability skills. Students tap into these skills and learn through her programs where they travel the world for the first time and step outside their comfort zone. And she shares how her journey of wanting to be a better leader, especially as a young executive, also reminds her what she could help her students learn. I asked her what skills looking back turned out to be important to the leader she wanted to be today. Letting go of imperfection, she said, was important.
Man, I love that question. Oh man, the skills that I found that really mattered and the skills that were not important. So I'm learning that perfectionism is not actually that important. And so, you know, me being this 20-year-old, I don't know, like maybe being coming into this like role in the shoes of this person who was just such a pillar in our community. And then having to lead a team with people who are like twice my age, more than that, dealing with parents who were twice my age, like talking to them, like having to deal with that. I kind of thought that in order to do this role well, I had to be a certain kind of way. And there's some truth to that, but there's some non-truth to that. So for example, right, I think about being in Korea all the time, actually. So another one of the things that I do, like I've worked with the New York Young Women's Advisory Council on policy recommendations for the city, and also with the United Nations Department of Global Communications Youth Representative Steering Committee. So I chaired that for a few years as well. And so, boom, we're in Gyeongju. We go, we have like a great time, you know, and by great time, I mean, we're working like 16, 17 hour days consistently. Okay, cool. No problem. And then like, I'm on my way to Seoul, you know, cause we're eventually coming back home. And so they're like, oh, Janae, where are you staying once you get to Seoul? And I'm like, I don't know. I'll figure it out on the train. I haven't booked my place yet at all. I ended up staying in Incheon. It was a really great time and whatnot. But it was just like, you know, I'm chilling. I'll figure it out. So I'm on the train booking my hostel location and then like making my way over there. But you can't do that when you're with other people's children. Like when I'm traveling with other people's children, I have to be like, we are arriving at 3:10 p.m. We're going to you get there by making a left turn at a 45 degree angle. And then you cannot have variables when you're taking care of the lives, because people give you the child and they're like, here's my baby. Please bring this child back safe and sound. And, you know, so I take that very, very seriously. So I would say that there's some truth to that, but I thought that I also had to just do everything perfectly. And what I'm learning is just like the skill of actually just getting started and being willing to be like, okay, this is rough, but it's a basis that we can work with. And, you know, getting feedback from other people, like knowing that you don't have to do everything yourself. I felt like, you know, I thought I had to wear like 8 hats at once. And now I'm wearing maybe like 5 hats, but that's progress, right? So like, you know, like being willing to be imperfect and get other people on board is like, I think maybe like one of the biggest skills, like realizing, oh, this is a task. This task doesn't mean that I got to do it. It means that there might be other people who also, like giving people the opportunity to also contribute to the mission that you love so much. That matters.
That matters indeed. Judea raises a handful of key points. Yes, being a leader means being more responsible, but that doesn't mean you have to do this all alone. Focus on your strengths. Tie back to what you can do and create a space for your teams to step in. Because this is why leaders work with others, not alone. It made me also appreciate what Monica Magliris shared in why she got to appreciate a leader who really cares for their people. Work together and also think twice about what you say and what you don't say.
Really knowing your stuff is really the only way to honestly lead a screen printing shop. But I think that in terms of just a business overall, I think it's just leading with intention and just making sure that you're present with your employees, you're understanding what they're going through, you're interested in them, because, you know, especially in a manufacturing environment where if they get stuck at a really long job and they're starting to get a little bored or something like that, that's exactly when I'll swoop right in. And while they're working, I'll start up a conversation with them, but I'll always redirect it to what they're doing, because I need to refocus them. And it's just, it's not being naggy or anything like that. It's just this gentle kind of persuasion And it works. You know, I've never had to say to anybody, get back to work. Never had to say that. I've never had to demand anything from them. I always ask. And so I think that's the thing is, you know, being humble and saying thank you. I mean, I worked for somebody growing up. I think I was there 19 years. Never once got a thank you. And so every time, I don't care what it is, even if someone just hands me a paper, I say, thank you. You know, it's just a little thing, but you know, people pick up on that. So managing your energy is vital to managing the energy in your space or in your company.
Meet my friend Monica, co-founder of Liberty Print, a print shop with over 50 plus years of combined experience in New Jersey. Monica's reminder on how to find that energy for your team really resonated with me as it goes back to the connected theme I heard from all my friends. Be human with a heart. So much of her leading or leadership training has focused on how you lead strategically, but not so much developing and honing your heart. And while some of us knew how important leading with heart is, this COVID time only reminded us even more why we need that so much. So as I look back at my question for today's episode, I'm circling back to two words as we think about how we might build better leaders for the future. Yes, we need leaders to be good at what they do, have expertise, and be good communicators. But most importantly, we need leaders who are humbled, driven, and who are human beings who recognize that they are serving other human beings. What stood out to you as you think about leadership? And what kind of leaders do you want to be? Tell me more. Thanks for joining us today. This is Monica King, your host at Dear Workplace. I hope you enjoyed today's show. Thanks to our guests for sharing your thoughts. Next, we'll be diving deeper into the importance of relationships in the workplace. Why does it really matter, and how do you navigate changing relationships from friends to bosses to colleagues? Bring your questions and thoughts, and I'll see you next time.
Hey there, this is Ravi Ladd, one of the audio engineers at Innovators Box. I hope you're enjoying Dear Workplace. A fun fact about me is that I'm also a petroleum engineer by trade and an online music production student at the Berklee College of Music. Personally, I love the insights that Dear Workplace provides me into all of my professional and creative endeavors. This show is brought together by our awesome team, producer Saren Oh, audio engineer Sam Lamer and myself, Kelly Gravo on marketing, website designer Akriti Pandey, graphic designer Monica Escobar, and Luke Helder on music. Dear Workplace is hosted and directed by Monica Kang, founder and CEO of Innovators Box. To continue the conversation of reimagining the workplace, visit us at innovatorsbox.com. Also, don't forget to subscribe, leave a review, and share. We'd love to hear what you enjoyed and your ideas for future episodes. See you next week.